Alright, hi everybody. So this is Carol from Segovia Quilts, and today I'm going to be showing you step by step how to make the t-shirt quilt. And this is the quilt that we're going to be making today. Okay, so the very first step in making a t-shirt quilt in general is to have the t-shirt that you want to put into the quilt. So let's go ahead and get all of our t-shirts together. Okay, so here we have the stack of shirts that we're going to be making this t-shirt quilt out of. These are from a client of mine. I'm making this t-shirt quilt for her. And here we have 23 shirts and a pair of shorts that she wants included in the t-shirt quilt. So what we're going to do is we're going to start off just cutting out the general image that we want to keep from each shirt. So we will start with this one. Now, what I did was I had her go through all the shirts and mark the images that she wanted to keep. Now, this particular shirt doesn't have anything on the back, so we don't necessarily have to worry about that. But she marked it, so we know that this is an image that she wants to keep, and she definitely wants it in the t-shirt quilt. So, what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and remove the tape. Now, if you're going to be doing this, I suggest using blue painter's tape or maybe masking tape. You don't want to use something like duct tape because then it'll leave residue on the shirt, and you definitely don't want that. So what we're going to do first is you want to just try and lay it out. You don't want there to be any, you know, major wrinkles, like a big wrinkle like that. Just want to lay it out. And I'm going to be using my rotary cutter today and my self-healing mat. Alright, so it's laid out, and now we are ready to start making our first cut. So what I like to do is I like to cut off the sleeves on both sides, so we'll start with that. Now, because there's not an image on the back, I'm not too concerned about making sure I find the seam line for the back of the sleeve. So we'll just go ahead and cut this off. There you go. And sometimes it's hard to get through if you get right on the seam. So we got that sleeve off. And you see, I'm not really being super careful. I'm just making a really rough cut. There. So we've removed our sleeves, and that we have here. Now, you can save these and use them in the t-shirt quilt. If you do, though, I recommend getting rid of the bottom part of the sleeve. This is where the armpit is. You know, after years of wearing a shirt, you're gonna get, you know, deodorant residue, you know, kind of caked in here. And you know how they tend to get the smell in it. But what you're gonna do is later on we're gonna be ironing all of these, and when the iron hits this section, it tends to create kind of a nasty smell. So if you're going to keep this to use, I recommend maybe just cutting off, I don't know, like maybe 4 inches or so. Just cut straight across both sides and throw this part away. You can keep the top, but I don't recommend using the bottom. Okay, so now that we got the sleeves, let's go on to the next part. Now what I like to do is I like to grab it and turn it on its side. So now we're looking at the shirt from the side. We're seeing through both armholes. There's the neck hole up top. Okay, so now what I like to do is I grab my scissors and I just cut right through the shoulder seam. So we'll cut through that, straight through the neck hole. And then the other shoulder seam. Now again, you'll notice I'm not really being careful, because honestly I'm not too concerned about the neck or any of that. So now we've got it completely opened up. Okay, so this is the back of the shirt, this is the front, and these are the armholes. So now we're going to separate the front from the back. And again, I'm going to use my rotary cutter, and I'm just going to cut all the way up. So, all the way up. All right. So now we have this large piece of material here. This is the back. Okay, that's the inside. And then this is the part that we're mostly concerned with. This is the front. All right. So now that we have our first logo, what I like to do is I just like to set the logos that I'm going to be using aside. And what I do is I do all of my cutting first, and then I go on to the next step. So this shirt is done. So let's go ahead and move that to the side. All right, so let's go ahead and do another shirt so that you can see. Now I'm going to do this shirt. Now this shirt has a logo on the front. This is the front. And it has a logo on the back. Now the logo that she wants in the t-shirt quilt is this one, so we don't need to include the one on the front. So I'm going to show you how to cut a shirt that has a logo on the front and the back. Let's just pretend that we want to keep both logos. Okay, so you're going to do the same thing that we did with the first shirt. You just want to lay it out, try and get out the creases. So we'll give it a little shake. There we go. All right. Much better. Okay. So, now what you want to do is you just want to take a peek at the logo on the front and the back and see how far away from the sleeve the logo is. So here we've probably got about 4 inches. And on the front we've got a little bit more. This is probably 5, maybe 6 inches. I'm going to check the side. This side's about the same. So we don't want to go too far in because we want to make sure that we leave enough space for our seam allowance on the back logo. So I'm going to take my rotary cutter and I'm going to try and cut. I don't know if you can see it on the camera, but right here is the seam of the front. But then in here, this seam right here is for the back of the sleeve. So I'm going to try and get right in the middle. So, cut right through there, and again, because you're cutting through the seam and the material, you might have to give it a little extra cut here and there if you don't quite make it all the way through. And again, a new blade on your rotary cutter will definitely help with that. So we got the first sleeve off. I'm going to discard that, scooch this over. Alright, so now I'm looking for my seam, and it looks like both seams are right on top of each other. So, I'm just going to cut a little bit on this side of the seam, just so I make sure I leave enough space for that back logo. There we go. Alright. Okay, so now we've got it opened. Okay, so now I'm going to do the same thing that I did with the other shirt. You can leave it like this, or you can go ahead and open it up, it's up to you. So we're going to cut the neck, or the shoulder, I mean. And there we go. Alright, so now it's completely opened up. So now, I'm going to grab the bottom, I'm just going to open it up. Alright. Okay, so now we've got this opened up, the logo is folded in half on top of itself, so there we go. And, you know, I'm looking over here, I got a good amount of space over here between the logo and where I'm going to cut. Let me just check the back. And it looks like we got about the same amount, so we're good on both sides. And like I said, you definitely want to check because, you know, you would hate to make your cut and realize that you either cut into the part of the image or you didn't leave yourself enough space to work with. So, but we're good with this one, so let's go ahead and make our cut. So I got a couple of spots here where I didn't quite make it all the way through. I could probably use to change my blade, honestly. Alright, so now we've got our front and our back separated. So here is the back, and this is the logo that she wants to keep. So we'll go ahead and remove the tape. And we're going to add this piece of shirt to the pile of keep logos. So we got that there. And then this is the logo that she does not want in the shirt, or in the t-shirt quilt. So this one, we're not going to do anything with this. You could save this if you want to keep this material here to use in the rest of your quilt. And I'll show you guys later how I use the extra material. So for now, we're just going to add this to our pile of extra material. Okay, so I wanted to go ahead and show you guys the pair of shorts that my client's having me add to the t-shirt quilt. I figured I'd show you guys how to process something other than a shirt in case you have something that you want to add to your quilt that isn't a shirt. So this is a pair of swim trunks. It's polyester, it's not cotton. So if you look, there is zero stretch that way and zero stretch that way. There is a little bit if you pull on the diagonal, but not much. So now for this, what I'm doing is this, I'm just kind of looking around just to see, you know, where I can make my cuts. I'm not gonna use any of the seams in the quilt. I'm not gonna use the crotch area. I'm not gonna use the top. I don't need the lining. These have a pocket on the back. I don't know if I'm going to be able to keep this. No, because it's a lining. Now there is, she did give me a shirt that has a pocket, a breast pocket, that I'm going to keep, and she actually wants it in the quilt. But for this particular pocket, I mean, we could keep it, but it wouldn't be a working pocket. So yeah, I'm probably not going to keep that at all. But to start, what I'm going to do, now inside you can pull the drawstring out, so we're going to pull this out through the back just to get that out of there. All right, so now what we're going to do is we're just going to go ahead and cut on the crotch seam all the way around, and we're just going to open these shorts up. So now I'm going to try and stay relatively close to the seam, or on the seam. Now it's got a double, it's got double seam lines, so I'm just going to try and stay in the middle. This way I can make sure I'm able to keep as much of this material as I can, because compared to a shirt, there's really not a whole lot of material on these pair of shorts that I can use. I'm just cutting there. Alright, now we're gonna go up. I got getting stuck on the lining back here. There we go. Alright. Okay, so I've cut it open on the crotch. Whoops, so that's some more. There we go. We cut it open right in the middle, so now we got both legs separated. So now I'm going to cut, this is the inseam of the shorts, so now I'm going to cut this open. There we go. Alright, now about the only seam that I'm going to be willing to keep from these shorts is the seam between the red and white and the blue and the stars, because that I feel is acceptable, but I'm not going to be keeping the side seam. And again, there's a pocket here, but I can't make that a working pocket for the quilt. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to cut up the side seam. Now this is the outside thigh seam. It's not very much I can get my scissors to stick. Alright, so we'll move that. So now I've got a quarter of the leg. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut off the top elastic. And looks like I'm going to need to cut right under this second seam line to be able to get right in here where they joined it, and the elastic is sticking out right there. So there. All right, so now we got the top. This I'm gonna discard, I don't need it. Okay, so now, with the exception of this here pocket, which I'm gonna go ahead and cut off this right here. Now I'm not cutting all the way through, I'm not going through the material, I'm just cutting off this pocket that's hanging on the inside of the shorts. There we go, just get that out of the way. Okay, so here is my first piece of usable fabric from the shorts. Yeah, alright, so let's add that to our keep pile. And I'll go ahead and do it again, show you on this section here. So again, this has a pocket over here, we're not going to be able to use it. So I'm just going to go ahead and cut off the top section here where the elastic is. So we'll just do this, we'll do it from the inside out this time. So you can see I'm just getting my scissors right in here, as close as I can to the elastic line. I'll pull up this pocket. Actually, we'll go ahead and cut this pocket off, get it out of our way. Alright, so now we'll keep cutting along the top. There we go. Alright, so this is our top. We don't need that. And we're left with this piece of usable material. There we go. Alright, so that's pretty much just how you go about using or getting fabric out of other articles of clothing that aren't t-shirts. And I'll do the same thing with the rest of this, this half of the shorts. And I just want to show you, she gave me a couple of other shirts. This is a polo shirt that she gave me. There's a little logo under here, there's a little logo under here that she wants to keep. And I'm going to process the shirt the same way. The difference is I will cut off the collar here. I'm going to cut off the sleeves. I'll cut open the shoulders. And then I'm going to cut off the collar because I don't need it and it'll just weigh down my fabric. This section here, this button section here, will be discarded. But this is also a beautiful color shirt. So I'm going to, once I process the shirt, I'm going to save this and use it in my extra material pile, and we'll use it throughout the quilt as well. So that's that. I'm going to keep processing these shirts, and then once this is done, we'll come back and move on to the next step. Okay, so I wanted to show you guys one more kind of shirt that you might encounter while making just honestly any t-shirt quilt. So this is a button-down shirt. So, I'm going to show you guys how to process a button-down shirt, or at least how I do it. So, what I did was I unbuttoned all the buttons, and then I'm going to open it so that it's the inside of the shirt is laying on the table. So, now originally I thought about maybe leaving this shirt whole and having one whole block be the front of the shirt with the buttons and everything, but I was looking at the pattern, and it's not a pattern that's, like, it doesn't match up on the front here, so let me see if I can show you guys. So, when it's buttoned up, yes, the waves look like they're maybe continuous, but when it's buttoned up here, like, I don't know if you can see. Let's see if I can zoom in for you. Okay, so right here, the mountain, it doesn't continue onto this side. You got a palm tree there, and it's not like a continuous picture. So had it been continuous, I probably would have tried keeping it whole, but since it's not, I'm not going to worry about it. So what I like to do is, like I said, I like to open it up and lay it with the inside of the shirt facing down on top of the table. And I'm smoothing it out because I'm going to cut on the seam line here. So I'm getting my rotary cutter, and I'm going to cut right along this seam line. I'm going to stop at the sleeve, and then I'm going to get my scissors, and I'm just going to keep cutting up. And right now I'm cutting through the armpit, and I'm cutting through the bottom side of the sleeve. There. So now I'm opening it up. So this here is the sleeve part. This is the shoulder, come down, and then this is the armpits right here. So now what I'm going to do is I'm still going to flatten it back out, and I'm going to cut along this seam line here. So come right along, and I hope I'm not getting my arm in the way. And I'm not really being entirely too careful. Oops. I'm staying, you know, as close to the seam line as I can, but I'm not, you know, I'm not getting all upset if I go off of it or a little bit into the shirt. There we go. And sorry if my arm's in the way. There, okay, so here is the sleeve. Again, I'm going to keep this because I might end up using this little boat here, but, and this material, let me show you guys. So here we go. I'm pulling it. There's really not a whole lot of stretch that way. We'll pull it this way. Not much stretch that way. There is some stretch on the diagonal. So just kind of showing y'all a little bit of what I'm working with. Right, so we're going to add this pile, or this shirt, or that piece of shirt, to our extra material pile. And then I'm just opening this back up, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to keep cutting. This is the shoulder seam. So I'm going to go ahead and cut that open. Go right through the collar, because I'm not going to keep the collar. Right through there. Okay, so now this is one half of the front of the shirt. This is the, what is that, left side of the shirt. So use your breast pocket. Here's a little piece of our collar. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut that off. I'm just going right through it. I'm not even anything. Alright, there. So this piece of material here is done and ready to use. Now when I do use it, the buttonholes are still in here. So when I do cut out what I need, you know, I'll end up cutting off this, or, you know, depending on what part I'm going to use, because there's some really pretty flowers and pretty scenery here. So this piece is going to go in my extra material pile. Okay, so now here's the rest of the shirt. So now we're moving over to the right half of the front of the shirt. So I'm just going to open it up, smooth it out, and again, getting my cutter, and I'm going to go right up the side seam. Alright, I'm going to finish it up with a pair of scissors, cutting through the armpit and into the sleeve. There we go. Okay, opening it up again. Now I'm going to cut out the sleeve section. Again, I hope my arm's not getting in the way. Come from this side. There we go. Alright, here's our sleeve. Okay, gonna open it up, and now we're gonna cut through the shoulder, straight through the collar. Okay, we're gonna cut off the collar. There we go, that's garbage. Okay, now I'm not gonna use any of the buttons, so what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna go through and cut off the buttons. And this is a good idea too, because like I said, we're going to be ironing all of our shirts, and we're going to have to put interfacing or stabilizer on all of, well, the majority of our shirts. And buttons, you know, depending on what kind of button it is, it might not hold up to the iron very well. So we just cut those off. Now we got this panel here to our extra material pile. And so now we're left with the back of the shirt. So this is the back. Here's the right armhole and the left armhole. So we're just going to turn this on its side, and I'm going to cut off the top. So now here's the collar. This section right here is the part that goes across your shoulder blades and your upper back. I'm going to cut all of this off. I'm not going to use it because there's not enough material here for me to use. And we got some pleats right here. There's a pleat here. There's a pleat here. By cutting right here under this seam line, we'll be able to open up that pleat and get just a little bit more material out of it. So I'm just cutting right under the seam line. Alright, there. See, so now we got this extra half inch of material on both sides. This garbage, don't need that. And now we got this big chunk of material. This is a beautiful piece of material. And now we can see the whole image. Alright, so this will get added to our extra material pile. So that's how you process a button-down shirt. And that would be the same thing for a long sleeve shirt as well. Okay, so now that we've finished processing our shirts and getting them ready for the next step, the next step is where we're going to be ironing all of the shirts that we processed. So you're definitely going to want an iron and an ironing board. So what we're going to do is first we're going to iron all the shirts nice and flat, and then we're going to add a stabilizer or an interfacing to them. Now, this is an example of stabilizer. This is it on the bolt still. When I buy mine, I buy it by the bolt because that's, you know, I use it a lot when I make the t-shirt quilts. But you can buy it by the yard. You can also buy it pre-cut. But today I'm going to be using this. Actually, I have some over here. Here we go. This is an example of some. Now, this is heat and bond, so it's not really the same thing, but you can buy a stabilizer in packages similar to this. You just need to find the one that's going to work best for your project. Now, I've not bought the stabilizer in a package like that for the t-shirt quilts, just because, honestly, you need so much of it that it's just cheaper to buy it on the bolt. Now, I found that usually 1 yard we'll do 1 t-shirt front and back. So about 1.5 feet for the front and 1.5 feet for the back. Now the stabilizer that I use, let's see if I can't show you guys here. Let me see if I can zoom in. Maybe that'll be better. Here we go. Gotta try not to get close to my iron. Okay, so there you go. Now I use the P44F. Now let me tell you right now, this stabilizer, you can only buy it at Joann Fabrics or maybe online somewhere. So here it is. This is Apparel Interfacing Basics P44F JAS Fusible Interfacing. And it gives you, get a little bit better. There you go. It gives you some washing instructions: machine wash warm, non-chlorine bleach, tumble dry low, or dry clean. And this is Pellon. Again, it's P44F JAS Fusible Interfacing. And it's very, very lightweight. It just gives the shirts just enough to keep them from stretching out while you're sewing it. So it's not very heavy. It's not going to cause them to be super stiff. Now, if you're going to go buy this from Joann Fabrics, definitely take a coupon with you. This is usually 99 cents a yard, but if you take a coupon, which there's always a coupon for Joann Fabrics, take the 50% off one, and you can get this at 50 cents a yard, which is just incredible. It's amazing. So definitely, if you're going to go buy it, take the coupon with you. It'll make it so worth it. So yeah, so let's get to the ironing part first. Okay, so I've got our first shirt here. This was our little Santa Claus shirt. This is the first one that I processed. So what I'm gonna do, what I do always with all of my shirts, is I iron them first before doing the interfacing. So I'm gonna lay it front side down to the ironing board. You always wanna do that. You don't ever wanna put an iron onto the logo because it'll melt it, it'll smear it, it'll ruin your iron, it'll ruin your shirt. So always put it face down. Smooth it out a little bit. Now I've got my iron set on linen, and I do not, I'm not currently going to be using steam. I'm just going to be doing just a regular basic heat iron. You can use steam. There's really no problem with using steam. I just don't have it on right now. So I'm just ironing over the whole logo, pretty much the whole shirt, just because I want to get it nice and smooth before I add my interfacing. Now for this process, for the interfacing, you might want to have a chair to do this because it's going to take you a while. So again, I'm just ironing out all the little ripples and puckers here and there. And you'll see your shirt will start to curl a little bit on the edges because it's the cotton and it's just, you know, you cut it, so it's a raw edge now. So, you know, but don't worry too much about that. Once you add your stabilizer, it won't do it anymore. Again, just keep ironing it. You're going to do this with all of your shirts. Again, I do this with all of my shirts before I add my stabilizer. It just makes it so much easier and so much nicer. The finished product ends up looking a lot better than if you were to just add the stabilizer without first ironing your shirt. Okay, so I've ironed the whole shirt from the inside. Remember, don't put the iron on the face of the shirt. Okay, so now we can start adding our stabilizer. So, let me grab it. And again, because I'm using it right from the bolt, I'm just going to open up a couple of yards. And I've got my table over here, so I'll just set the bolt on the table, and then I'll just pull what I need. There we go. So now, if you've never used stabilizer, there's two sides. You won't be able to see on the camera, but there's going to be a smooth side, which is what this hand is currently touching, and then there's going to be a bumpy side, which is what this hand is currently touching. You will be able to feel the difference. So the bumpy side is the glue, the stuff that's going to allow the stabilizer to stick to the shirt. So you always want to make sure you have bumpy side on the material. Because if I were to put it on backwards and put my iron on it, I'm going to have a hot mess with my iron. It's not even, I don't even want to think about it. So now you can cut your stabilizer before putting it on the shirt if you want. I generally don't, but again, I process so many shirts at a time that it's just easier, it's faster for me to just bring the stabilizer over here, lay it on top, and then bam, I get right to it. There you go. So now the directions on the stabilizer, they say to put the stabilizer on and get a damp washcloth, put it over top, and then put your iron over top of the damp washcloth. Now that's how it says to do it. I don't like doing it. I tried it once before. I didn't notice a benefit to doing it. But what I do is, what I have done in the past is I'll do it just like this. And over time, certain spots on the iron are hotter than other spots, and some of the stabilizer will stick to different parts of my iron. So what I do is, I go back and I grab one of the pieces of t-shirt that is either in my extra material pile or it's a shirt that I know I'm not going to be using. So what I do is I grab it and I lay it over top of my stabilizer. this one I have to worry about it sticking to my iron or anything like that. So now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start ironing my stabilizer. Now you do see here, there is some stabilizer overhanging my shirt, and it will get stuck to my ironing board, but if you let it cool, when you take the shirt off, the stabilizer will just come right off the ironing board. But again, I don't know, it could just be my ironing board cover that lets it just come right off, I'm not sure, so be careful. I don't want to be responsible if you accidentally get your shirt stuck to your ironing board. So I've got my shirt on top, now I'm just going to set my iron, bam, right there. Now I like to count to 10. I put it 1, 2, it's a very slow count, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Pick it up. Now you can see the shape of the iron. Now what I like to do is I like to turn my iron upside down and then put it right next to it. So 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Pick it up, and again, you see the shape. Now I do this because if I were to go, you know, point up, point up, point up, down here you're going to have one complete row, but then up here you're going to have like a triangle and a gap, a triangle and a gap. So I just kind of rotate between putting it, you know, this way and then the other way. So this is what you're going to do to all of your shirts. So you figure 10 seconds for each spot and then move to the next one. You're going to be standing for quite a while. So if you, you know, bring a chair, maybe put on a TV show that you really like, because you can just pick it up, look at the TV for 10 seconds, look back down, relocate the iron, TV, iron, you know, it's definitely a process. So this is going to be what we have to do next for our shirts before we can move on to the next step. So, there. Once I finish this top row, what I'll do is I'll pick up this shirt, and then we'll look at our stabilizer and see and make sure it is actually fusing to the shirt. You definitely want to check, because if you sit here and let's say, I don't know, your power turned off and your iron isn't even on anymore and you for whatever reason don't realize it, by looking to checking, or by looking and checking your stabilizer, then you'll be like, oh, okay, hey, it's not stabilizing or it's not fusing, what's the deal? Is my iron not hot enough, or am I not holding it on long enough? And then you can address the issue. Alright, so we did our first row, so now we'll open this up, and we'll take a look. Now I don't know if you can see in the camera, but there's a line right here from where my iron was sitting. So this is the bottom of the iron, here's the point. So you can see where the iron actually sat on the stabilizer. So right here, here's the line of my iron. So I know that this part of my stabilizer is on my ironing board, which I knew it was gonna happen, it's no big deal. So all you wanna do is you just wanna kinda pick around. Now my iron didn't come all the way up here, so I'm not too concerned about this not being fused on there. But, let's see, over here, here we go. So now this part was fused up here, but this part wasn't because I didn't go all the way. So over here, my stabilizer, oh, it came off a little bit. So, it's not completely fused, so maybe I need to hold the iron on a little bit longer. What you could also do is put your shirt back. There we go, put this back. And then you can hold the iron specifically on the edge. Because honestly, it's the edges of the shirt, or where the stabilizer, that needs to be really held down. Because if you can't get the edge up, you're not going to be able to get the middle up. So you just hold that there. Couple of seconds. Come over here to this side. And 10. Alright, so now that stabilizer should be nice and fused. You want to let it cool down. You don't want to just dive on in because you might end up burning your fingers or something. So, pull over here. A little bit. So, that's not terribly bad. And honestly, I'm not even going to be using this part of the shirt, so I'm really mostly concerned about this. But again, go with what your stabilizer directions say and you shouldn't have any problem. So now let's return to this part. So it's cooled down, so all I'm going to do, slide my hand, and you hear it separating from the ironing board. There. So, but you can't pull them apart, so I know that it has been fused to the shirt. So we're good. And how you can really tell is, let's look at the front. Okay, so here's the front of the shirt. So it has some stretch this way, has a lot of stretch this way. So now let's look at a piece that has been stabilized. Look at that. Zero stretch. And that's what the stabilizer does. There's a little bit this way, but that's to be expected because that's the grain of my stabilizer anyways. But side to side, which is where this had the most stretch. Let's look again. Look at that. Whole lot of stretch. Come back over here. Nothing. You can hear it popping. It's tight. That's what we want. Alright. Checking the camera. Okay, so, oh, got a little bit stabilized or fused over on that side. Okay, so now let's go ahead and do the next row. So all I'm doing is I'm checking the shirt on the bottom, smoothing it out, and you see this little tuck or this little curl right here. Once we put the stabilizer and fuse it down there, well, it's not going to quite reach, but that's alright. But anyways, on this side, because this is going to be stabilizer, you're going to see it's not going to curl anymore. So I'm just smoothing it out, making sure my stabilizer doesn't have any tucks or creases. Alright, let's get our, I guess safety fabric you can call it. Smooth that out. And then back with the iron. So, one, two. Okay, so I've come to the edge, so I'm just going to go a little bit more, one little sliver, and that'll cover up the rest of the shirt. And then once I finish this sliver, we'll go ahead and check this new section and see how it's looking. Okay. Alright. So we'll pull off our safety fabric. And again, I don't know if you can see, but here's the line from where my iron sat. You can see there's the point, and then here's the bottom of the second, or that last placement. You can feel it if it's, you know, still too hot. Again, for this part right here, it's best to wait till it cools down because then that glue will have hardened back up. If you try and do it now, I mean, it's coming off, yes, but it's kind of goopy. So I'm just going to leave it be, wait for it to cool, and then we can peel it off. But it looks like it's been stabilized, and you can kind of tell when you're looking at it. If you can still see a lot of dots, then the glue hasn't melted sufficiently. So, you know, when you put it on, pretty much you just want to see white. You don't necessarily want to see white dots. And when you see it in person, you'll understand better what I'm talking about. So I'm going to keep doing this for all the rest of my shirts. Now you don't have to do this for every kind of material. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. So now, some of the shirts that my client gave me are not cotton. And here's an example of one. This was a like a little Hawaiian shirt that she gave me. Now if you look, there is no stretch side to side, and there is no stretch up and down. There's a little bit on the diagonal, but that's all right. So this shirt is relatively stable. Now the reason why we stabilize it is because when we go to the sewing machine, because it's a t-shirt material, it's going to stretch and it's going to distort your blocks. This material is not going to stretch. It's not going to distort my blocks when I start sewing them. So I do not need to stabilize this, which is good because it'll save time. Same thing with the shorts. These shorts are not cotton. They have zero stretch side to side. and zero stretch up and down. Again, there's a little bit on the diagonal, but that's all right. So these shorts are very stable. I don't have to worry about them distorting when I'm sewing them. So I don't have to stabilize these shorts either. Now the ones that you want to stabilize, again, are mostly going to be your cotton shirts. So let me grab a cotton one. Here's a cotton one that we're going to have in there. So here we go. There is stretch side to side. And there is stretch up and down. So I definitely need to stabilize this shirt before I take it to the sewing machine. So, and that's how you can check. Check to see if you need to stabilize it by pulling it. If there is give, you need to stabilize it. Something else I'd like to add about stabilizing is not everybody stabilizes their t-shirt quilts. You do not have to stabilize them. It just allows you to sew your blocks together with a little bit more accuracy. I think it makes them easier to work with. It's a lot less stressful when you know your block is going to finish at the size that you cut it and it's not going to stretch and be larger. It's personal preference. You do not have to stabilize them. I stabilize all of my t-shirt quilts for my clients. It just allows the finished product to be a lot crisper and a lot sharper. So if you want, you know, to have, you know, sharp points, crisp lines, I definitely recommend stabilizing them. If you're not really, you know, if that's not really your main focus, you just want like a nice, I don't know, cuddly quilt, you know, do it without the stabilizer. It'll still be just as nice. It'll still have, as you know, just the same amount of love that you put into it, whether you stabilize it or not. So it's really your call. And another tip, I don't know if it's a tip, a suggestion, or maybe, because I do this so much, I do not actively use the iron to put my stabilizer on. What I have done is I bought a t-shirt press. I bought this online on Amazon, and this is what I use. It's 15 inches by 15 inches, and I put my shirts in here, put my stabilizer in, and I close it down, and it stabilizes 15 by 15 inches of the shirt at a time. This is a lifesaver. This has saved me many hours and hours of sitting there with my iron, putting on my stabilizer. I don't necessarily recommend buying this unless you're going to do a lot of t-shirt quilts. I think this was, I want to say maybe $200 or $300. So I mean, it's an option. It is out there if you want to do it, if you have disposable income like that, even if it's just for one t-shirt quilt, hey, by all means, knock yourself out. It definitely saves time in the long run. So I'm going to get back to stabilizing the shirts, and then from there we'll move on to the next step. Okay, so for the next step in the making of this t-shirt quilt is, once you've gotten all your t-shirts cut out and they are ready to go for the next step, you want to lay them out, and this is where you're going to be smoothing out the shirts and then adding in the stabilizer. So what I like to do first is I like to put my shirt on the ironing board, and I like to give it a nice press. Now I do this with the logo down on the ironing board. You don't ever want to iron over top of the logo, because the heat of the iron will smear it, distort it, ruin it, and then you'll make a mess of your iron too. So I've already ironed out this shirt and I started putting on the stabilizer. So all I did was I ironed the whole shirt all the way down, and then I put it on the ironing board and I started putting on my stabilizer. Now, if you're watching this video, it's because you already have some knowledge on quilting, and hopefully you have some knowledge on stabilizer. So, you want to go ahead and start adding your stabilizer to all of the shirts that you're going to be using in your t-shirt quilt. Now, the stabilizer that I like to use is this brand. Let's see if I can zoom in for you. This is Pellon, and it's apparel interfacing. It's P44FJAS fusible interfacing. Now you can only get this particular, model, style, You can only get P44F at Joann Fabrics or maybe online, maybe Amazon. I've not been able to find this anywhere else. Walmart doesn't have it, Hancock Fabrics doesn't have it. Michaels doesn't really have any kind of material or anything either. But I've only been able to find it at Joann Fabrics. Now, if you're going to use this stabilizer and you're going to buy it from Joann Fabrics, I definitely recommend using one of their 50% off coupons. This is generally 99 cents a yard. If you use your 50% off coupon, you can get it for 50 cents a yard. That's a huge savings. And to do a t-shirt quilt, I find that you need about 1 yard of stabilizer for one t-shirt. That's stabilizing the front and the back of the shirt. So it takes about 1 yard per shirt. So you say you've got 25 shirts, you're going to need about 25 yards of stabilizer. So if you're looking at $1 a yard, you know, 25 bucks, but if you take that 50% off coupon, then you can save, you know, a good amount of money. Especially, like, I buy mine by the bolt, obviously. So, and the bolt is 48 yards. So, you know, I'm able to save half of that by using that little coupon. So that's definitely something you want to look into. So, right, so let's go ahead and start adding your stabilizer on. Again, if you're watching this video, it's because you have an idea, you know, a little bit about what you're doing. So I'm not going to go into the steps on that. So go ahead and add your stabilizer. If you need step-by-step instructions on how to do that, why don't you check out my other video, the detailed step-by-step instructions. Yeah, all right, so let's finish up the stabilizer. Okay, so I figured I would show you guys how I use my t-shirt press to put the interfacing on the shirts for our t-shirt quilt. I know most of y'all aren't going to have this, but I figured, well, why not? You know, you might be curious on how I do it. I'm just going to show you guys how I do it. So I start off first by laying the t-shirt onto my platform here. I smooth it out. Now, I did iron these. This is not, this is like a linen shirt. Well, no, not even linen. I don't know. Almost more like a canvas. It's an Izod shirt, so if any of y'all have ever worn or bought an Izod shirt, then you kind of have an idea of the material I'm talking about. So I put it on there, smooth it out, and I'm just going to lay my interfacing over top of it. Now, I've got my fan going full blast, so the interfacing is blowing around a little bit. And I just smooth it out, and again, my glue is facing down onto the shirt. Now, my t-shirt press comes with this pressing sheet that I put between the interfacing and the heat plate. So I put this between it, and then I'm just going to pull down on my handle, and it locks into place. Now, I've set my timer on this to go for 13 seconds, and it's at 275 degrees. So once it's done, it'll start beeping, and then I'll open it up. And it's spring-loaded, so I gotta kind of put my chest into it to make sure it doesn't pop back up, because I've done that before. It'll just swing right back up. So now, since I wasn't able to get the whole shirt in one press, now I just scooched it over. And now I'm getting ready to do the second half, and I'm just smoothing out the shirt and my interfacing. Go. Okay, now I'm going to put my pressing sheet on and press again. Again, 13 seconds at 275 degrees. And this applies pressure. That's that sound you hear when I push it down. It clicks in. It's spring-loaded, so it clicks in to apply the pressure for the needed amount of time. And then I disengage it. Now, at this point, I'm going to cut my interfacing, because right now it's still connected to the bolt. So, I'm just coming over here. I'm doing a rough cut. I'm not measuring. I'm just cut, cut, cut. There we go. All right, so now I'm going to pull it up. And I always try to be careful, because obviously this plate up here is the heat plate, and I hate to, you know, run my knuckles against it on accident, or my arm. Alright. Okay, so now you can see here I'm short. I don't have enough interfacing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back to my bolt. And I'm just going to kind of eyeball it. And then I'm going to cut what I think will be a sufficient amount to cover that bottom space. Put it on top. And it covers it perfectly. Alright. So we'll get my pressing sheet. Put it in. Lock it in. And this, my t-shirt press, it's Power Heat Press. By fancierstudio.com. Okay, so got that, and I got one more section to do. So I'm going to slide it over. And again, smooth it out, the shirt and my interfacing. I can cut this tag off. I don't have to. I could leave it. It'd be fine if I left it. Smoothing it out. Now I've got a little space over here that doesn't have any interfacing, but I've got a couple of squares over here that I can use to fill in. Alright, there we go. Perfect. Okay, so my pressing sheet one last time. Now these shirts that I'm processing are taking a bit more interfacing than usual. The gentleman that these shirts belonged to was a little bit larger, so obviously I'm going to need to use more interfacing. Alright, but like I said earlier, usually you'll use about a yard per shirt. So, alright, so there's that. So let me bring you guys over here. Whoops. So you can just have a peek. Okay, so this is the shirt. Now it's all interfaced. It's not going to stretch anywhere. I got all of it. And you see I have some extra stuff hanging around on the edges and stuff. I'm not going to worry about it. When I first started, I would cut it off and save it. Because I was, you know, I thought, okay, I'll save it for any kind of applique work that I might do. But I've not done it. So I've got a drawer full of scraps. So at this point, I'm not going to save any of these. Once I cut out what I need, that's just going to get trashed. It's garbage. So, but yeah, so that's how I use my t-shirt press to apply my interfacing. All right, so I'm going to keep applying the interfacing to the rest of the shirts. And once I'm done with that, then we'll go on to the next step. Okay, so we've finished stabilizing all of our shirts. And now we are ready to move on to the next step. So the next step in the process is going to be cutting the blocks from each shirt for our t-shirt quilt. So now this is where we get into the measurement part. I do all of my t-shirt quilts, the blocks measure in inches of 4. So 4 inches, 8 inches, 12 inches, you get the picture. You can do it in 2s or 3s or, you know, whatever number you want. I found 4 to be pretty good. So now what we're going to do is when our t-shirt quilt is complete, all of our blocks are going to be, you know, say 8 inches by 8 inches or 4 by 12 or something, you know, some measurement of 4. But before you finish the quilt, you have to cut a rough block. And with the rough block, you're going to have to add to the size your seam allowance. So we're going to cut this block, but we're going to want to add 1/4 inch on each side. So that would make our block, say, 4.5 inches by 4.5 inches, or 8.5 inches, or 12.5 inches. And so that's you have to factor in your seam allowance. If you don't, you're going to end up with messed up blocks. So with that in mind, we're going to start measuring out where we're going to cut this particular shirt. Now for this step, you are going to need some rulers. Now I have these two rulers. This ruler here is 6 inches by 24 inches. And this one is 8 inches, well, 8.5 inches by 8.5 inches. So you can see this little orange part here. This ruler factors in your seam allowance for you. So there's a half inch right here, then there's a half inch over here. I like using two rulers when I do my measurements, and you'll see why. So let's start. Now, this logo is pretty much straight up and down. You will encounter logos that are, you know, off at an angle, and the words go like this, maybe, instead of, you know, across, straight, and normal. So what I like to do is I like to start with my long ruler, and I'm going to put it on the side, and just to try and figure out where our logo stops. So obviously the tip of this P here is the logo that goes the farthest to the side. So that's where we need to, you know, pay attention to. So then I'm going to put my little ruler over here. I'm going to bring my long ruler and butt it up with this one. So now what I'm doing is I'm going to try and find somewhere on the shirt or on the logo that I can adjust my ruler so I can make sure when I cut my logo out, it's going to be nice and straight in the block. So what I like to do is I like this one is curved. It's not necessarily, I mean, it does go straight, but it's got a little curve to it. So I like to put the edge of my ruler, I'm going to put it on the bottom of this H and the bottom of this N, just the tips. So put that there, there. Okay, so that's straight. So now I'm going to bring this ruler and butt it up to this one. So now we're just going to slide it over, and what I'm doing is now I'm squaring it up. I'm putting this ruler on the edge of that P because that I know that that right there is the farthest my logo is going to go. So now I got the P on the edge. I'm checking again just to make sure my ruler is on the edges of that H and N. There. So now I have my rulers centered. Well, not necessarily centered, but I know that my logo is going to be straight. So now I'm going to slide this ruler up, and what I'm doing is I'm trying to find the part of the logo over here that goes the farthest to the right. So it looks like the edge of this S is the farthest our logo is going to go. So right here we are at 14.25 inches. So my next measurement of 4 is going to be 16 inches. So that means this block is going to be a 16-inch wide block. And again, that's just going off of here, off of this top whitest part of the logo. So knowing that it's going to be 16 inches, now I need to find, well, the total so far is 14.25. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to find the halfway point between 14.25 so I can mark it. Okay, so half of 14 is going to be 7. Half of 1/4 is going to be 1/8. So the middle of my shirt is right here. The middle of my logo is right here. So now that I have found that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring this ruler and I'm going to put it right at my 7 1/8 mark. Okay, so now here is where you're actually going to start drawing lines on your shirt so you can mark it out. And so for that, you're going to need marking utensils. And here's what I like to use. I've got these two pieces. These are tailor chalk. They come in a package, usually together. Got a blue and a white one. But then I also have a marking pen. Now this one is two marking pens in one. The purple is disappearing ink, and the blue is mark be gone. The purple will disappear usually 24, 48 hours after you mark it on the shirt. It'll disappear just with air hitting it or with water hitting it. The blue one won't disappear until you get it wet. So these I like using for my lighter color shirts. Obviously, this is black. You're not going to be able to see either of these on it. So for the black shirt, I'm going to be using my white tailor's chalk. So I'm just going to pick an edge. You know, it's the same all the way around, whatever edge. And then I'm going to draw a line on this ruler. There. So I hope you can see that little white mark. Let me move it. Can you see it? Yeah, see, so there's my mark. So I marked the top. I'm not touching this ruler. Now I'm going to just hold it to keep it from moving, and I'm moving this ruler up to the 7 1/8 mark down here. I'm going to give it another. Sometimes it's hard to get the chalk to come off on the logo, so I'm just going to find a piece of the shirt down here and mark it down here. Alright, so now I've got a line up top and a line on the bottom. So now I can use my long ruler, turn it on its side, line it up with my marks that I have on the top and the bottom, and now I'm going to draw a line through the whole shirt. And it doesn't need to be super dark, just enough for you to be able to see it, because you're going to use this to measure out in a little bit. Okay, so now we've marked up and down, so this is the middle of the logo. Okay, so now we need to measure this way to find the middle of the logo up and down. We found it side to side, now time to do up and down. So to do that, we're going to go ahead and turn. Now I like to turn it, you don't have to. There, okay. Put my chalk down. Okay, so again, we're going to put our ruler on the edge so we can find our farthest edge. And that's, okay, there we go. So I'm just lining it up. It looks like the very edge is going to be right here. Now, with this, because you already have your line, you can put that chalk line on one of the lines on your ruler, on the grid. So I'm just going to put that chalk line right underneath one of my lines. Alright, and I can see that nothing else goes past here, so we know that that is the edge of our logo. Okay, so we'll switch my ruler out. And you might think this is silly, you might be like, well, why didn't you just put the small one up here? You will have some shirts that have logo kind of everywhere. I've seen a shirt where it was a splash, and there were water splashes all off on the sides. So you have to figure out which little splash of water is the farthest little splash. So yeah, just something to keep in mind. Okay, so I'm lining it up. Alright, so now we'll bring in this ruler. Line it up against this top one. Okay, and so now we're looking down here. We need to try and figure out how far down our logo goes. Alright, so again, I'm going to line that chalk line up with one of the lines on my ruler. Give it a little nudge. There we go. Okay, so the farthest down my logo goes is 12 7/8 inches, so just shy of 13. So now you could try and divide the 12 7/8 into, I'm not going to be that much of a stickler about it, so instead I'm just going to go half of 13. So we know half of 12 is 6, plus the other half is going to be 6 1/2, because 6 1/2 plus 6 1/2 gets us 13, right? Okay, so 6 1/2 right here is our center point. So now we can pick up this little guy, bring it over here, and line it up on the edge at the 6 1/2 mark. Again, I'm going to get my tailor's chalk, draw a little line. Don't touch this one. Move your ruler down here. You can hold it to keep it from moving. Line it up again with 6 1/2. Alright, okay, so we got that. So for this, because we're at 13, I know my next measurement of 4 is going to be 16 inches. So as of right now, our block is going to be 16 inches by 16 inches. Okay, so now we can pick this up and connect our lines. All right, there we go. There. Okay, so now we have our shirt perfectly marked out. This is the very center of this logo. You cannot get more centered than that right there. All right, so now that we have marked it, we are now ready to cut. Okay, so now here's where the math comes in. Okay, so we know our block is going to be 16 inches wide. And with that, we need to add in our seam allowance. So we need 16 and a half inches wide. So what I like to do is I like to measure from my center line. So we'll start with this one first. We're going to measure to the right and to the left. From here, we're going to measure out. So if it's the total is going to be 16 and a half, that means each side should be what? 8 1/4, right? Because 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. Yeah. Okay. So 8 1/4 this way, 8 1/4 this way. And then that's where we would cut. Okay. So this ruler here is only 6 inches. So I need to add my little ruler to give me the additional inches. So we got 6. This is 7. 8. And now I need to put this chalk line right underneath my 1/4 inch line right here. Okay, all right, so then we'll butt this one up. Okay, so now let's double check. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 inches, 7, 8 inches, and 1/4. Perfect. All right, so before you start cutting, you want to check your logo. Double check to make sure that you have more than enough space here to do your seam allowance and then still have space between the logo and the edge of the shirt. So you can see here we've got 1 inch and just a smidge less than 1/4 before our logo will be at the edge. So we are good on that side. All right, so now we can start cutting. Okay, so I got my rotary cutter. I'm going to hold this ruler. I'm going to start at the bottom and cut up. There. We've made our first cut. Bam, just like that. All right, so now we need to measure and cut on this side. Okay, so I'm going to scoot it over, make sure you guys can see it. There you go. Okay. So, we got our 6 inches, got our little ruler, so we've got our 6, 7, 8, and 1/4. So I'm putting my 1/4 inch on that chalk line. There we go. Now I'm going to get this ruler and slide it up against it. Okay, so we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 inches, 7, 8 1/4 inches. Okay. So that is perfect. Again, check your logo. So up here, we've got 1 inch and let's see. There we go. Okay, so we've got more than enough space. We've got our 1/4 inch here for our seam allowance, and then we'll still have this gap here between the logo and the edge of our shirt, and it'll be perfect when we sew it. We're not going to have to worry about going into the logo when we sew it together. So now we can go ahead and make our cut. There we go. All right. So I'm holding my ruler, starting at the bottom. Go through that. I don't think I quite made it through that seam up top. There we go. Well, there we go. All right, I need to change my blade. There, okay. So now let's look at our shirt so far. Okay, so look at that. Beautiful, perfect. Got plenty of space on both sides of our logo. Okay, so now we can cut the top and the bottom. Okay, and we're going to do the same thing. We're going to get both of our rulers. We're going to put our long ruler over here. So we got our 6 inches, and we said that it was going to be 16 inches by 16 inches. So now we'll add our 1, 2 1/4. 1, 2 1/4. Alright. And you can also use this middle line over here to put on one of your grid lines on your ruler. And that'll just give you, you know, just that extra assurance that you know your block or your logo is going to be nice and straight. Okay, so we got this marked, or placed. Now we're putting this ruler against it. Okay, so we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 1/4 inches. Okay, and we're checking, we're looking at the top of our logo. We have more than enough space between our logo and where we're going to cut. Okay, so now that you've got that measured out, time to cut. Hold the ruler and chop away. There we go. Perfect. Okay, time for the bottom half. Okay, so we got this. We've got 1, 2 1/4. There it is. And you always definitely double check your measurements, because once you cut, there's just about no going back. Okay, so we got it marked. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 1/4. Okay, we've got our chalk line underneath the grid mark. Check the bottom of the logo. We are good. So, time to cut. Hold it. Boop. Just like that. All right. So now, we have our first block for our t-shirt quilt. Now let's go ahead and check it against my mat. Let me zoom you guys out. So we'll check our measurement. Give you a tilt down. All right. Okay. So 1 inch over here. Come over here. We are perfect right at 16 1/2 inches that way. Let's check the other side. Okay. 1 inch over here. And again, perfect right at 16 1/2 inches. Beautiful. Okay, so now that we're done with our first cut, we have this extra material that we cut from around the shirt. Now, this here, this is the collar at the top. This is garbage. You can't use it. It's not even big enough to use in the shirt or in the t-shirt quilt. So, discard that. Now, this, the rest of this part, you want to check to see if you can use it, because you might still be able to. This is already stabilized, so if you need extra material in your t-shirt quilt, this is perfect place. This is a perfect place to get it from. Now, I don't personally like using the black or the white extra material in the t-shirt quilt, just because it doesn't really add anything to the quilt. If I'm going to use extra material, I like it to be a color other than black or white, you know, like green or pink or purple or red. So I don't generally save the black. You can if you want, I don't. But let's say this wasn't black. Let's say it's a different color. To figure out if you can use it, you have to check the measurement of what you have left and see if it even works with the measurements that you're using in your t-shirt quilt. So mine is in 4 inches. So I can look over here, and I know that this little strip over here is not at least 4 inches. So I cannot use any of this in the quilt. So I'm just going to cut that off and discard it. There we go. Garbage. Let's check this side. Okay, so this is 4 inches. So right here we got more than 4 inches, and it goes to almost to the top. So what we could do is we could cut this, because this is not thick enough. This right here is not 4 inches. So we'll discard that part. But this is still usable material. Same thing with this section right here. So we could finish our cut right here. So it doesn't have to be perfect because, you know, you're not using it for sure. It's just a maybe. There. So you can keep this and potentially use it. You could do a 4x4 inch block out of this. You could do a 4x8 inch block. Yep, more than enough material. So you can hang on to this and use it to fill in an empty spot somewhere in your t-shirt quilt. Same thing with this right here. All right. So that's just something to keep in mind. Okay, so we cut out our first shirt, and I wanted to pull out another shirt. I wanted to pull one that might be a little bit more difficult than the first one that we just did. So now this shirt has a circle logo. So circles tend to be, well for me anyways, a little bit more difficult to cut out because it's harder to locate, you know, the edge really and make sure that you're going to be right in the middle. This one is a little bit easier because it has the star in the middle. So we can use these points to help determine where, you know, where we are to make sure we're going to be right in the middle of this circle. So I'm going to start going side to side. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put these star points, or pretty much just this line of the star, on one of my grid lines on my ruler. So we'll turn this around. There we go. Okay. So we're going to put my 3-inch line right on the top of that star. I'm going to get my other ruler over here. And I'm just going to slide this ruler this way until I get to the end of this red circle here. So we'll slide it over. Make sure it's still lined up nicely on the star. All right, so now I'm looking. I'm trying to figure out, okay, where is the end? And, you know, it might be hard because it's such a light, well, I mean, it's a dark color, but, you know, it's hard to tell. So you could bring this one in instead, line that up, and then slide this guy over. So line that up nicely. There we go. All right. Okay, so we are right there at the edge, and we know that there's no more logo past this line right here, so we're good there. Okay, so now we're gonna hold this ruler down. We are not gonna let it move. We're gonna move this one up and down because now we need to find the outermost edge on this side of the logo. So I'm looking, looks like 10 1/8 is the widest part of our logo. Okay, so essentially the center of our logo here is going to be a little bit over the 5-inch mark. So we're just going to bring this down a little bit. Now we're going to go ahead and mark. Now I don't believe either of these two colors will show up on this, so I'm going to go ahead and use my white chalk line. Okay, so now we'll bring this ruler over here, and I'm gonna set it just a hair over the 5-inch line right here, and now I'm going to mark on the shirt up there. Move this one down here, and again I'm gonna set it just a hair over the 5-inch mark line. There we go. All right, so now we can draw a line straight through, connecting these two. Line it up. There we go. Alright, so now, you might be looking at this line, and you might be thinking, okay, it's a little off on this point, and it's definitely off on the star. Let me zoom in so you can see what I'm talking about. There, okay. So right here, we are about, maybe it's a small 1/4 inch off. Now that's not because we did anything wrong. It's because this logo might not have been centered when they put it on the shirt, or it might not necessarily be, I mean, I don't know. but it's definitely not from our measurements. So, and I've come across this a lot. I've done a lot of t-shirt quilts, and there have been several shirts where I'll draw my line, and it does not look right at all, even though I know my measurements are dead on. So if you come across something like this, don't worry too much about it. Definitely check your measurements. Make sure you actually measured correctly. But if you know your math is right and your measurements are right, don't let something like this worry you too much. Okay, so we'll zoom back out. All right, so now let's go ahead and do our other measurements. And this is a really thin t-shirt. It's like that super lightweight t-shirt material. This is really comfy. Okay, so now we're going to put this guy over here. We're going to put him right on my chalk line. And I'm going to come butt him right up to the edge of this red right here on that line. Alright. Get my other ruler. And I'm going to put my 3-inch marker line right on that chalk line again. And it just helps keep everything, you know, nice and square and even. Okay, so now this guy's not going to move. We're going to move this one up and down so we can figure out what our farthest point is. Okay, and it looks like 9¾ inches. So even right there, those measurements are not the same up and down as it was side to side. So right there we know the logo is not, you know, perfectly round and centered. So, okay, so 3/4 inches, or 9¾ inches, is going to be our measurement. So now we need to find the center point. Okay, so we know 1/2 of 8 is going to be 4. 4½ would be 9 inches, and then we still have 3/4. So, looking at 4¾ would be here, and 1, 2, 3. So 4⅞-ish is going to be our halfway point. And you can kind of look at it and you can see, okay, well, yeah, that looks about right. Now, if you were to come up and say, oh, yeah, 3/8 is 3½, and you can see this is your 3½-inch mark or marker, that's definitely not right. So, you know, just make sure, take your time, be careful, do your math. So we got 4⅞ as our halfway point. And you don't have to be specific. Like, you could always just round up to 10 and say, okay, I'm going to make 5 my half inch, you know, or my halfway point. And honestly, nobody's going to be able to tell, because the difference between 4⅞ and 5 isn't a terribly large amount. So, I mean, that's just on you. Do what you, know, do you. Okay, so we're going to move my ruler. 4⅞. I'm going to do my line. Bring it down here. 4⅞. There you go. Alright. So now we'll connect our lines. And you can line up, I'll line up my 13 marker line with my 2 lines here. Just give it a little bit more squareness. And draw my line all the way across. Beautiful. Okay. There. So now we can start getting ready to do our cuts. So we'll start off with our 6-inch ruler, which I do believe this is going to be enough. I think this is only going to be 12 inches. So, because what you could do is you could start off with your smallest measurement, which is 4 inches, right? So, you're going to start with, that means 1/2 of 4 is going to be 2. So, you put this chalk line right underneath your 2-inch marker. Okay, we still have a whole lot of logo. Okay, so you add another 2 inches. Okay, so right here, that gives us 4 inches, which would make our block 8 inches, but we still have logo hanging off, right? So you got to add another 2 inches. Okay, so right here. So this is 6 inches, which would make our finished block 12 inches. Six over here, six over here, right? Okay, so we have no more logo sticking out. And I can see that all of my logo is underneath my ruler, which is good. That's what we want. So now this is only 6 inches. We still need that quarter of an inch to bring our finished block to 12 and a half. So I need to add a quarter of an inch over here to make sure I account for my seam allowance. So all I'm doing is I'm using this little ruler here, and I'm putting my quarter of an inch seam or marker line on my chalk line. Okay, so now I'm going to line up my just a regular old marker line on my ruler on this chalk line. Make sure it's nice and square. All right, beautiful. Okay, time to cut. Make our first cut right here on this side. So start at the bottom and go all the way up. There we go. Okay, so we did 6 1/4 over there. That means we got to do 6 1/4 on the other side, right? Okay, so we'll put down our little ruler to get our 1/4 inch seam allowance. Okay, bring up our next one, get our 6 inches. Okay, so now we got 6 1/4 inches. Okay, hold it, and then cut. There we go. All right. Okay, so now we've got the sides cut out. Okay. So lay it out. Now we've got to cut our top and our bottom. Okay, so we'll do the same thing. You can start off with your smallest measurement. Finish block of 4 inches. Nope. Okay, finished block of, there we go, what is that, 8 inches? No, not good, 2 more. Okay, finished block of 12 inches, because this is 6, and then there'll be 6 on the side, so finished at 12, and we are good. All of our logo is safely under the ruler. We're not going to cut nothing off. Okay, so let's make sure it's lined up. Alright, and cut. There you go. Same thing on the other side. So this was 6 1/4, this needs to be 6 1/4. Okay, our logo is nice and safe and under the ruler. We are ready to cut. I really need to change my blade. Okay, there's a little extra fuzz right there. No biggie. Okay, so let's move this stuff. This here, garbage. Okay, so here is our finished block. So let's measure it. We'll tilt you guys down so you can see. Okay. Okay, so we're over here. We're measuring 12 and a half, which is what we need. Okay, so we'll turn it now. We'll get it right here. 12 and a half. Beautiful. Okay, now what I'm gonna, well, I don't need to. I was gonna say what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna mark top on here, but I suppose you don't really need to because you could turn it this way and it's not gonna look right. You could turn it this way and, you know, now you're a Satan worshiper and turn it this way, still not going to look right. So this way, we got our line going through one of our points. So we know that this is going to be the up position for our block. So, yeah, so here's your second block. You got it measuring 12 by 12. Our first block was bigger, so now we've got blocks of different sizes, which is perfect for the t-shirt quilt that we are making. All right, so you're just going to keep doing this for all of your shirts. Okay, so let's finish those up. Okay, so I'm going to show you guys what I do when I'm getting ready to cut the logo out of my shirt and there's not enough material on one of the sides for me to get the measurements that I need. So let me show you what I mean. Okay, so we're going to deal with this side first. So I want to cut this side. So I'm going to put my ruler. It's a pretty big logo, so I know it's going to be at least a 12-inch block. So to get me a 12-inch block, I need 6.5 inches on this side, right? Or 6.25 inches on this side and 6.25 inches on this side. So I'm lining up my quarter inch mark on this ruler on my lines that I already marked. And I'm bringing my ruler. Okay, see, I still have logo right here that's not safe under my ruler. So the next measurement from my 6.25 would be 8.25, which would give me a 16.5 inch block. So let me move my ruler over here to get the additional 2 inches. I'm just lining it up. So I got my 2.25 plus my 6 brings me to 8.25 inches on this side of my midway line. So now look over here. Let me zoom in a bit. Okay, so my ruler is about 0.5 inch on top of the neck hole, whatever you want to call it. When I do my t-shirt quilts, I don't include, I don't include seams. You're not going to see any arms seams or any seams on the bottom, and you're not going to see any neck seams. So this poses a problem for us, right? Because I'm at my needed measurement mark, and there's not enough material for me to get it. So what do you do? So let me show you guys how I handle that. Let me zoom back out. We'll turn it back. There we go. Okay, so now what I do is I bring my top ruler down until it's just under the seam of the neckline or of the collar. So when I do that, that now brings me, I've lost 0.5 inch, which is about what I expected because that's about how much my ruler was on top of it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to line this ruler up on the closest measurement, just so it's not in between. So right now my rulers are measuring, we got 6, 7, and 5/8 inches. Yes. So I've got 7 5/8 inches of material on this side before, up until my middle marker. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go ahead and cut right here. So we'll give it slice all the way. I changed my blade, by the way. Okay, so now you might be thinking, okay, well, how are you going to get your block to be the right measurement? Now that I've made my first cut, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get my tailor's chalk, and I'm going to write right here, short. Okay, so I know this line here, or this cut, is short. I am missing inches, or, you know, centimeters, millimeters, whatever. I'm missing needed material. So now I'm going to finish cutting the logo out because I know I'm going to be good on the rest of it. But when I'm done, I'm going to take the bottom of this shirt, this extra material, and I'm going to cut out a strip, and then I'm going to sew it to the top. Once I sew it to the top, then I will remeasure and I will cut off where I need to. I will get my, what was it, 8.25 inches, right? Yeah, I think it was. Yeah. So once I add that extra material on here, then I can measure and cut and we'll be good. So let's go ahead and finish cutting up the shirt. Okay. So now for this side, I'm going to go ahead and do my normal measurement, my 8.25 inches, because I have more than enough material. Just because it's not the right measurement on this side doesn't mean you have to change your measurement on this side. So we're lining that up. Got my, okay, so we got 6, 7, 8.25 inches. We are good. Now, this particular logo was a bit wonky on the shirt. So I tried my best to, I don't know, measure it or cut it in such a way as that it would look all right. But yeah. All right, so this is a pretty wide shirt, and I ran out of mat, so now I'm going to bring it over and finish up these seams. There we go. Oops. Come on. There we go. All right, so this is garbage. It's not big enough for me to use. All right, so now let's do the sides. Okay, so if I did this 6 1/4 inches, it's still not enough, so we're going to add 2 more inches to it. We got our 2 inches and our quarter, 2 1/4. I'm just lining it up. I used my disappearing ink pen, or it's air and water soluble pen, and I marked it earlier today, so it's been a couple of hours and it's already starting to disappear on me. Okay, so I've got my 8 1/4 inches measured out. Now I'm getting ready to cut. I know my logo is safe. So, boop. There we go. This is not big enough to use, so garbage. And same thing on the other side. We're going to go 8 1/4 inches. So let's line up. There we go. All right, we're good on this side. So, here, come on this side so you can see. There we go. There, all right. Okay, so here is our semi-finished block. So let's take a look at the measurements. I'll tilt you guys down so you can see. Okay, so we are finishing at 16 1/2 over here, and we are finishing at, now we know this is going to be short, right? There we go. And over here we are finishing at 15 7/8 inches, so we are let's see, what is that, 5 1/8 inches short. And you know, it sucks when you get stuff like that because it's so close. You were so close, but no cookie. So yeah, okay. So now what I would do is I would take my extra material from the bottom of the shirt, put them together, pretty sides together. And it doesn't have to be the same, you know, length or whatever. So I would just put pretty sides together, sew all the way down, and I like setting my seam, so I would set my seam, of course, and then I would fold it back out and iron it open. Then I'll measure again and make the cut that I need, and then once I do that, then this block here will be ready to go, and it'll be ready to go to the next phase, which will be the design phase. So yeah, so I figured I'd show you guys that. And you don't have to do that like I did. If you're fine with having a neck seam in there, or even an arm seam, by all means, go ahead and put it in there. I mean, ultimately, it's whatever you want, whatever's going to make you happy with this t-shirt quilt. But I figured I'd address it just in case you came across it and you said, well, how the heck do I do this? So, yeah, alright, so I'm going to keep cutting out all my blocks, and then we'll get ready for the next step. Okay, so now we can move on to the next step in the process, but first I wanted to show you guys. I added the extra material onto one of the shirts that was short on the side, so I was short about a little over 1 inch. So I went ahead and I added the extra strip on there, and I just kind of wanted to show y'all what that looked like. So there's the back. And I use it's material from the same t-shirt, it's just from the back of the t-shirt. So yeah. Okay, so on to the next step. So I lay my quilt blocks out on the floor. when I'm going to start designing the actual quilt top. But I wanted to show y'all that I do mark out the floor so I can get the measurements right. So just kind of wanted to show you real quick. That's just Scotch tape with some permanent marker on it. And I've got it all around. That's the midway point right there. My other corner, midway point, corner, and midway. So, yeah, so I just mark out the floor. And that's for queen size t-shirt quilt. So I marked it out, and then what I'm going to start doing is I'm going to start laying out the quilt blocks, and I'm going to pretty much try and start in the middle, or where the middle would be. So yeah, so I guess let's start doing that, and I can show you guys how to design your quilt top. And I'll try and talk louder, because obviously when I'm away from the camera, I won't be as loud. So yeah. So here's my stack of blocks so far. So what I do is I just kind of keep it off to the side, and then I'm going to pull blocks from it as I go. But what you want to do is you want to start with the block that's going to be in the middle. And my client wanted this particular block to be in the middle. So I'm going to use my halfway markers so I can try and figure out where about the middle spot is going to be. And so I've got that right about there. And it doesn't have to be perfect. No one's going to, you know, be measuring to make sure it's in the middle exactly. But that's about the middle point. So yeah. So I'm going to take off my shoes, because as this gets bigger, I'm going to be stepping on the actual t-shirt blocks, and I don't want to be getting, you know, crud on them from the bottom of my shoes. So now you just want to start building your quilt top out from the middle block. So I'm just kind of spreading everything out. This way I can see all the blocks that I have available to me. I'm just going to grab a random block. So just going to kind of lay it. I'm not laying it anywhere specific. I'm just putting it right next to this one. But I am off-centering it. It's not going to be, you know, like straight line right here. I'm just going to put it off-center. You want to try and keep it in measurements of the 4 inches. So this is about 4 inches right here. So I'm just going to put that right there. Then I'm going to get my next block. So, let's see. And I try and keep colors separate. So, like, I've got an orange block here. I personally don't want to put a red block right next to it, because they're really close to the same color. And I really want to kind of just spread it out, keep it really random. So, yeah, so I'm picking a darker color there, and I'm going to get this one, and we'll put it up top. You want to try and keep it straight, just so you can stay nice and organized. And I'm just grabbing random blocks. I'm honestly not even paying attention to the color or to the images. I'm mostly paying attention to the color, because that's my biggest concern, because I don't want like a grouping of red or a grouping of black, or you know what I mean. Over here, you can see that this is hanging off. So you might be thinking, okay, well, here, let me zoom in. Let me make sure you guys can see what I'm talking about. There, okay. So you see how that little block right there is not lining up right here in the corner. And the reason why that is because you've got two seams in there that when you sew them together, you're going to be losing material. So for each seam, you're going to lose a half inch. So we've got the seam between the minion block and the little blue block. So that's a half inch. And then you've got the seam between the blue and then the red and white block. So that's another half inch. So when you actually sew this together, the pumpkin face and these three blocks here are going to line up perfectly on this side right here. So so you're gonna see that a lot when you're laying everything out. Stuff isn't going to line up perfectly. But once you get everything sewn together, it'll be beautiful. So I'm just gonna keep building my t-shirt quilt out from here. So I'm gonna do that, and then I'll come back and show you guys what I've come up with. Okay, so I've got the majority of the quilt top laid out, and this is what I've got so far. So you can see it. And like I said, I tried to distribute all my colors so that I don't have two of the same color next to each other. And I think it looks pretty good. Now, when I first got these shirts, I said, okay, this is a good amount of shirts. But you can tell that the Hawaiian shirts that she gave me provided a lot of material for this quilt. So I feel like a large portion of this quilt is Hawaiian shirts, which is all right because as you can see, like from this one right here, it's really pretty fabric. So so I think that's all right. But one thing I wanted to talk about was, y'all remember how I said to keep those extra pieces of fabric, the shirts that I put in my extra fabric sack or pile, and I want to show you guys what I do with them. So I've already done it to a couple of spots, but when you lay everything out, you're ultimately going to have empty spots, or spots that you don't have enough t-shirts, or that's probably going to be it. You don't have enough t-shirts, or you do have enough, but for whatever reason, the layout that you have still has empty spots or blank spots. And so here's one. Here's an empty spot right here. Now this is 4.5 by 8.5 is what I would need to fill this spot. But up here, you can see I've already filled. So this spot, and this spot, there was nothing there. It was blank. It was empty. And I needed to fill it. So this is some of the extra material. And you can see it's got the fusing or the interfacing stabilizer on the back. So all I did was I cut out the size that I needed, which was 4.5 by 4.5. And I put it right there in that spot. So, and I've got three spots left in my quilt top that need to be filled. So I cut out three all three of these are 4.5 by 8.5. So I cut them out, and I'm going to go ahead and fill those in with you guys watching. Oops. So just laying it out. And where's the other one? Here's another one. All right. There we go. So obviously I've got two of the same shirt right next to each other. So I could go back and try and change it up. So what I could do is here's another one. This is 4.5 by 8.5. I can switch these two. Here we go. Switch that, put that one there. And I could put this one here. See? And these two are actually the same material or from the same shirt. So I can try and switch these around. Just pull this one down here. Move the red back up there. And then I can put this one here. See, so you can just kind of move things around to try and get it to either fit or to change the colors that are next to each other. I mean, you're pretty much not limited to moving stuff and changing it up. So this is the quilt top so far, and you'll see I don't go all the way to the edge over here, but up at the top I'm all the way at the edge. So let me show you. See, so I've come all the way to the edge on both sides. Here we go, my edge is right underneath. There we go. So I'm a little short, I guess you could say, a little short on this side and the bottom, but the measurement, the size of my layout is, it's in between, it's still a queen, but how I do it is I take the smallest size that a queen can be and the largest size that a queen can be, and I go in the middle. So that's what these markers are. They are the middle between the largest and smallest queen size out there. And I'm still going to actually add a border to this. The Izod shirts that my client gave me, I'm going to cut them into thin strips, and I'm going to put a border all the way around. And I think that'll be a really nice, a really nice touch, because it's kind of a baby blue and almost like, not quite pink, but maybe more like of a salmon color. So I still have to do that. But I wanted to show you guys how I do it and what I use those extra pieces of material for. And something else I was thinking about when I was laying everything out was, I know up here by this pumpkin face, I had told you guys, you know, don't worry if it's not lined up, because that'll happen. But I was thinking of a way that you guys can try and prevent that is, as you're laying your quilt blocks out, what I like to do is I tend to overlap them, and it helps kind of compensate for the seam allowances. So over here it's not so bad, but over here is where I did it a lot, because stuff just, it starts to not line up as you lay everything out. So here you go. This is a 4.5 by 4.5 inch square. Same thing with this, and you know, everything's in the increments of 4. But this little block right here that needs to be filled is obviously way smaller than my actual piece of material. And that's going to happen. So what I do is I just lay it over top. But like I said, once you actually start sewing everything together, it'll work out perfectly. Everything will be aligned. And once I sew everything together, it'll look pretty much exactly how it looks right now. It'll just be even. So, like, this is not even. Once it's sewn together, it will be even. So, yeah. So now what I like to do, once I have it all laid out and I'm happy with the layout and the design, I take pictures. So I take one picture of the entire quilt top, and then I take pictures in segments. So I'll do, you know, like this bottom half right here, and then I'll come over here and I'll do this half and same thing. And then I put the pictures on my computer, and so when I start sewing it together, I'm referring back to my computer and I can look and see exactly which block I need to get next or sew together next. So that's how I like to do it. You could also put this on a design wall. I'm actually going to enlist my husband to build me a design wall. He doesn't know yet, but, well, he knows now. So I'm going to be doing that. But you could lay all of this out on a design wall. If you have bad knees or bad back, or you just really don't want to be crawling around on the floor, go ahead and put all of this on a design wall and then lay it out like that. It'll work just the same. So I'm going to take my pictures, and then I'm going to break down my quilt top. I'm going to break it down into quadrants, because I will try and sew it together in quadrants. And once I do that, we'll go ahead and head over to the sewing machine, and I will show you guys the next step in the process. Okay, so now we are ready for our next step in the process. So what I've done is I've got all of my quilt blocks here, and they are stacked in the order, they're stacked in order by quadrant, and all I did was, so here's my quilt. I took quadrant 1, 2, 3, 4. So, you know, all of the blocks that are up in this part of the quilt are all stacked together. All of these blocks are stacked together. So there's the 4 quadrants. I've got my computer loaded, and you'll see I've got the pictures that I took of my quilt on the computer screen, and I'm going to use that to sew my blocks together. Okay, so we'll zoom out. I've got my sewing machine set up, and then over there I've also got my iron set up and ready to go, because when I'm sewing them together, I will finish my seam, and then I'll go ahead and set my seam, and then press it open. And I do that with all of the seams for the t-shirt quilts. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to zoom in. This way you guys can see me sewing the seams. And I'm going to show you pretty much how to put this t-shirt quilt blocks together. Because honestly, this is probably going to be one of the more difficult things if you're not really an experienced quilter, or if this is your first t-shirt quilt maybe. So let me go ahead and get the first few blocks that I need ready to go, and then we'll start sewing. Okay, so I've laid out the first 7 blocks that we're going to be sewing together. Now let me zoom in to the picture. Okay, so now we're going to be sewing the minion, these two little blocks, this blue one, this one, and this long one right here. We're going to be sewing all of these together. And for the most part, it'll be relatively easy. Let me zoom out here, and you can see. So I've lined them up, and this is exactly how they are in the picture. For the most part, it'll be relatively easy. These are all going to be straight seams. You'll be able to complete the seam. The part where it will be getting, I guess, more difficult or slightly more complicated is when we try and join the minion to this set of blocks. And you'll see what I mean once we get going. So I'm going to move the minion over because we're going to sew these individual blocks together first. Let's see, I'll go ahead and zoom in here. Alright. Okay, and I've got my machine set up with, actually looks like I got my black thread on there, but when I sew the blocks together, I'll be using my white thread, and I'll also be using white in the bobbin, so let me check and see what color I got in there. I believe I got black in my bobbin, so yeah, so let me go ahead and change that. And I use white when I do all of my piecing. I don't know. I mean, you could, if you had like a majority of black blocks, I suppose you could go with black thread. But you don't have to. I mean, generally you're not going to see the thread. So I always use white, but I mean, it's really up to you if you'd rather use black or even an entirely different color altogether. I mean, by all means, go ahead. Whatever is going to make you happy and whatever you want to put in your quilt, then that's up to you, really. And for all of the sewing that I'm going to be doing, not just the piecing, but even when I actually start quilting the quilt, I will be using my Juki TL2010Q. It's a great machine. It's still considered a residential machine, but it can produce kind of commercial esque products, I guess, if you will. So I'm just threading my machine right now. There we go. And I'm just using regular cotton thread. I've got a spool of thread. I believe it's like 1,000 yards, something like that. Something crazy like that, because I do a lot of sewing. So, yeah. Alright. So I got my machine threaded and ready to go. My feed dogs are up. Alright, so now we can go ahead and start with our first set of blocks. Let's see. Okay, we're good on time. All right. So, let me make sure that you guys can see this in the camera. Whoops, sorry about that. Let's see. All right. Yeah, okay, good. Okay, so here's the first set of blocks that we're going to be sewing together. And they are going to be sewn together right here. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to put them faced towards each other. Just going to line it up, make sure everything's nice and even. And then I'm going to lower my presser foot. And here we go. Now the thing about quilting is you don't have to do a back stitch when you start your stitching, and you don't have to do one when you end, because all of this part right here is going to be encased inside the quilt. So you don't have to worry about it, you know, coming undone on you and the quilt falling apart. Nothing like that. All right, cut my thread. Okay, so we just made our first stitch. I'm gonna check my stitching, make sure it's good. This is just a little, the tail of my thread got picked up in the back, but that's not a big deal. So the stitching looks good. So now what I'm gonna do is I'll zoom out so you guys can see what I do. I'm going to, well, I guess I'll keep it zoomed in a little bit. So now I'm going to take what we just sewed, and I'm going to go ahead and bring it over to the iron, and I'm going to press it. So I'm just laying it down flat, nothing special. I'm just going to give it a little bit of heat. I do have my steam on, and I'm just going to open it up and press it back. There you go. And that's it. There we go. So, let me zoom out. Alright, so here we go. Here's our first set. See? Like that. Our seam is nice and laying down in the back. Beautiful. Alright, so let's come back over here. We'll zoom back in. Out a little bit. There we go. Okay. Alright, so we've got that. So now, we can attach our next block, which is going to be this guy. Now, let's see, let me make sure you can see that. Okay, so if you look at the top and the bottom, it lines up perfectly. See? So we don't have to worry about how it was overhanging. Well, not this, but before I sewed these together, it would have looked like this. There. So you see how it's overhanging? But, like I've said throughout the video, once you sew them together, you're going to lose material, and that accounts for your seam allowance, and then once you, you know, keep going and going and going, everything ends up lining up perfectly. So, we'll tilt you back a little bit. Alright. So now, all I'm going to do is I'm going to make sure this block is facing the right direction, and it is. Okay, this is the right direction, so I'm going to lay it on top. There we go. It's going to line it up on the top and the bottom. Put my foot down. And off we go. Our second, and this material was kind of fraying. I didn't have to stabilize it, but the more I kept moving it around, the more it started to, you know, fray off a little bit, but that's all right. Okay, so we've got that stitch done. So now I'm going to go ahead and take it to the ironing board. I'm going to press it. Okay, so we've got a press, and this is what it looks like so far. Okay, here's the back seam. Our seam is lying down nicely. Alright, so Let me zoom out. Okay, so this little section here is done for now. I'm going to move on to these three. So we'll just move this one over here. We'll bring up this one, and this one. Okay, so now the next section, according to my picture back there, is these two have to be sewn together, and then this strip right here is going to get sewn to the top. So let's go ahead and sew these guys together. I'll zoom in so you can get a better foot of the a better picture of the foot. Sorry. Little focus for you. There you go. All right. And again, my machine is a Juki TL2010Q. Okay, so I'm going to put these pretty sides together. I'm going to spin it around since this is the side that we're sewing on. Okay, so I'm lining up the top and I'm lining up the bottom. All right. There we go. Okay, and here we go. Going to press it. I'm going to set my seam first, and again you just put your iron on top of the seam line that you just sewed, and then I'm going to open it up and press back. And so now this is what we have. So this is sewn together. Again, here's the back. Very beautiful. Alright, so now we can add our next block, which will go right on top. And let me make sure you guys can see that. We'll zoom out a little bit. There you go. Okay, so this will be it. And again, now that I sewed these two together, these are the same length as this top block, so it'll fit perfectly. All right, so now we'll put it, making sure my block is the way, the direction that it needs to be. So we'll go ahead and put it. And we will get it sewn together. Alright, let me line it up. Ooh, okay, so I'm glad I did this. Okay, so I was lining this up, and this is what it looked like, right? But if you remember, when I brought it over here and I sewed it, I had turned it around because I needed to sew on this side. Well, it's good that I just saw this because had I done it this way and sewn this to it, this is upside down. There's a little, there's some houses right here. So, but since it's good that I was paying attention and I caught this before I sewed it together. Although even if I had sewn it together, you can take it apart and correct it. So it wouldn't have been a big deal. But so we're going to keep lining this up. There we go. I'm just raking my fingers across it to move it down here a little bit. There, alright. And when it's not completely level, you can just scrape your fingers across it and it'll move it just little hairs at a time. Okay, so get that there. Get a couple of stitches going here. Yeah, I'm just checking on my seam under here just to make sure it's laying down nicely before I keep going. Alright. So now I'm going to go ahead and press it. Here I'm setting my seam. right now, and then I'm lifting it and pressing back what we just sewed on. There we go. Alright, so here we have it. Okay, so now you can see the blocks that we've just sewn together. Okay, so looking back at my picture, these blocks here will get sewn to these blocks here. Okay, and then once we do that, then we can attach the minion, and then that's when it starts getting, like I said, complicated. Okay, so we'll go ahead and check the orientation, make sure these are right, make sure these are right, and then we'll go ahead and lay this on top, and then we're going to go ahead and sew. So let's turn it, get everything nice and lined up. And you can line up the top, get in a couple of stitches, and then line up the bottom. There we go. So I'm lining up this part right here, and then I'm going to look at the rest over here. All right. Okay, now I'm looking at the end over here. Lining up this point, and then I'm just looking all along here because this is a longer seam, so you just want to make sure everything is where it needs to be. Almost to the end. Alright, so we've completed that seam. There's the back. Alright, so now I'm going to take this to the iron. I'm going to set it. Okay, now I'm going to roll it back and press it. Alright. And here we go. Get some lint on there. Alright, so here's what we have so far. Okay, and everything is nice and lined up. I love it. I love it when it works out. Okay, so now comes the minion block. Okay, so now let's refer back to the picture. There we go. Okay, let's zoom in. Alright, okay, so now, our minion block, you can see, is not, it doesn't go all the way to the bottom. Now, this little cloud block right here is the first one of the blocks that we sewed together. See, so there's a little cloud block. Okay, now looking back at the picture, the minion is not sitting flush with the bottom of these rows or these blocks that we just sewed together, right? He is kind of sitting at the top and then stopping before the clouds. I meant waves. He's stopping before the waves. So let me show you how to handle a seam like that, because this style of t-shirt quilt, you're going to have a lot of them. Let me zoom in because I want to make sure you guys can see it. Okay, so Minion is going to be on the right side. Okay, there you go. But again, he's not going to be lined up with the bottom. He's going to be lined up at the top. And if I just set it there and move it all the way, it comes right to the bottom, which is exactly where it needs to be. I don't think you guys can see that. No, you can't. Here, so I'll come over here. So I'm lining it up at the top right here. And it's not sewn, I'm just sliding it along the surface. Okay. Okay, here we go. And here's the bottom. Okay. So now when we sew it together, it lines up perfectly with this right here. And that's exactly where it needs to be. So, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to flip Minion over. I'm going to put his face down on top of these blocks right here. And I hope you guys can see my hand. Yeah, okay. So, I'm going to go ahead and do that. We'll flip him over. And we'll lay him down. Okay. So now we can go ahead and sew this seam. But this one's special. This one's different. And I'll show you guys what I mean by that. Okay, so I'm just going to line it up at the top, and I'm going to take a couple of stitches. There we go. Okay, there we go. A couple of stitches. Now I'm going to check the rest and make sure it's lined up. Okay. Alright, so let's keep going. Okay. And again, I'm just lining up this long edge here. The longer the edge, the more you have to make sure everything is lined up and where it needs to be. Pins. If you'd prefer to use pins, by all means, go ahead and use pins. All it does is help keep everything exactly where it needs to be. I don't generally use pins when I'm doing a t-shirt quilt, just because, I don't know, I just prefer not to, personally. Okay, so now I'm coming to the end of where I need to stop. Okay, so now let me make sure you guys can see. Okay, so this is the end of my Minion block right here. But because the Minion stops short of this block, it doesn't go all the way to the end, we cannot come all the way to the end of the seam because we have to attach another block to this part right here. This is a whole nother seam, and we have to attach another block to it eventually. Now, if we finish this seam right here, we are not going to be able to sew another block onto this edge right here. So what you want to do is you want to stop your seam, I don't know, maybe 2 inches before the end. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually do a back stitch or two, and then I'm going to cut my thread. So let's go ahead and do that. Okay, so I'm going to back stitch 1 or 2 stitches. And then I'm going to go back. Okay, and then I'm going to cut. There you go. All right. Okay, so, and you can check. Oh, you know what? Oh, yeah, okay, good. Okay, so that's the end of my thread right there. And then here's, well, I hope you can see, my bobbin thread right there. But I've got those 2 little extra stitches in there that'll keep this from completely ripping all the way open. Okay, so now we're going to go ahead and take it to the iron. I'll go ahead and show you guys that. Let me zoom back in a little bit. Okay. And actually, this is good for me to show y'all. Okay, so. So we're just going to set the seam, put in a little bit of heat, a little bit of steam. All right. Okay, so now we need to press this open. Okay, so I'm just going to drag it open. I'm going to put my fingers up under here against the seam, and I'm just going to kind of push it open. And all that's doing is making sure my seam stays nice and flat underneath. Okay, so now I need to press this and make sure that it stays the direction that I want it. The Minion is far enough away from where I actually need to iron that I could iron and be relatively safe. So I would just go like this, put a little bit of heat, come all the way to the end, and like that. But, as I mentioned in the beginning of this video, before I actually started putting on the stabilizer and anything, you have to be very careful with your logos, because if your iron touches it, it's done. Done, done, done. So, I like to keep an extra piece of material. This is the back of one of the shirts. I like to keep it nearby. And so what I would do is I would do the same thing. I would roll it back, finger press it, and then I just lay this on top. And then I can bring my iron. I can just go, bam, right across it, right across the whole thing. I don't have to worry about accidentally getting the minion. Or, you know, if I slip and I'm like, oh no, I got the logo and I'm done. So, yeah, so you keep that handy. Okay, so here's what we have so far. Here is our t-shirt block so far. Not looking too shabby, is it, huh, guys? All right. Okay. So, now we'll redirect you guys back over here. Okay, so we've got this first little section sewn together. Okay, so now let's see what section we can start working on next. And then I can show you guys how to do, how to, you know, work with this kind of seam here. Okay, so I've got the next block that I'm going to attach to our little minion guy and these six blocks over here. I'm going to go ahead and attach the pumpkin face block. Okay, so now, this is how it's going to look. Pumpkin face is going to go on the bottom of minion, and it's going to go right next to these waves right here. Now, you can see pumpkin face is way bigger than minion, and then the waves over here. But this is good, because I can show you guys how you can continue the seam, because you remember, we couldn't finish the seam over here with minion because we have to attach a block to the bottom of this. So, what you do is, again, look at your pictures, look at your layout, your design, and make sure that this block is where it needs to be. Okay, so we know pumpkin has to go on the bottom of minion. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab minion, I'm going to bring him and lay him face down on top of the pumpkin block. So, we'll go ahead and do that. Okay, and again, you can use pins right here if it'll help you keep everything nice and organized. By all means, go ahead and use pins. Okay, I'm not going to use any. Okay, so I'm just doing a rough lineup, and I'm going to turn it towards my sewing machine. Let me make sure you guys can see that. Let me zoom in for you. There we go. All right. Okay, so my block came, it moved a little bit, which is all right. Figured it would. Okay, so I'm going to line minion up over here with the corner of pumpkin face. Okay. I'm going to do a couple of stitches. Now, I'm just going to readjust. There we go. Okay. Again, readjust. Okay, now I'm coming to the end, so I'm, now again, because minion doesn't go all the way to the end of pumpkin face, I cannot complete this seam because I have to eventually attach another block right here next to minion. Okay, so I'm going to keep going. I'm going to stop about 2 inches from the end. And that's probably good. I'm going to backstitch a few stitches. Alright, and I'm going to cut my thread. Alright, see? So right here, I did not finish that stitch, which is good. Got my little locking stitch, so that's pretty secure. Okay, so now I'm going to go ahead and bring this over to the ironing board. I'm going to press it, and then I'm going to roll it back. And then I'm going to go ahead and iron that. Okay, so setting my seam. There you go. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and roll it back. Okay, and again, be careful with your logos. You don't want to melt Minion or your pumpkin face. So be careful. There we go. Okay, so let me bring it back over here. Let me zoom out so you guys can see. Okay. Put this in here. There we go. All right. Okay, so here's the seam that we just did. Okay, so now over here, we can keep going on this seam if we want to, or we could wait till we attach more blocks to the bottom of this section here. Okay, for the purposes of helping you guys learn how to do this, I'm going to go ahead and take a couple of more stitches in here, and I'm going to stop again at the end, and then, because I know eventually I'm going to have to add another section or blocks or whatever to the bottom right here. So what we do is we just fold this back over. Okay, and we've got this. Now I'm going to go ahead and turn it over because I need to sew on this side. And I just need this section to be over on the right. So that's all I did. So I'm just going to line it up a little bit. Bring it back under the sewing machine. Okay. And we're going to continue this stitch. Now, because I ended my stitch and I did a little locking stitching right here, I'm just going to start my new stitch. I'm going to start it maybe like a half inch into this stitch, and I am going to go ahead and back stitch right here. Because I'm starting in the middle, I just want to make sure that I don't have to worry about it ever coming out, so I'm going to go ahead and start, and then I'm going to back stitch. Let me zoom in. Alright, there we go. Okay. Okay, so I'm just making sure everything's nice and lined up. We'll start in about a half inch. There it is. Alright, we'll just line that up. Okay. So we'll do a couple of stitches and back stitch. And we're off. Okay, now right here, let me pull this back. Right in here, we've got this seam line is going to meet up with this seam line. Now what you want to do is on this side right here, just pick it up, give it a little peek, and just make sure they're lining up together. That'll give you very, very nice and crisp joining lines. Okay, so that's what I'm doing. I'm just looking, just jiggling it around a little bit just to make sure it lines up nicely and everything is nesting together. Okay, and then keep going. There you go. Just got to make sure the rest of it's lined up. And sometimes you'll have to, you know, move stuff this way or tug it that way, you know, whatnot. It's to be expected. And it's a little more difficult because the block that's underneath pumpkin face is shorter, so I'm having to make sure I don't move my finger and it slips around. Okay, so here we go. Okay, so we're coming up to the end of my seam line. Okay, I'll take about another half inch or so. Alright, so now I'm going to back stitch and finish it off. Alright, there we go. So, let's zoom out. Okay, so now I'm going to go ahead and take this to the ironing board. Okay, will set my seam. There we go. Now I'm going to roll it back. And this will get progressively more difficult as you sew more and more blocks together, obviously, because your quilt's getting bigger. Okay, so now I'm just ironing that, setting it. Alright. Got a little wrinkle right here. There we go. Okay. So, there you go. So, now let me, got some more lint on there. Now, so let's zoom in so you guys can see what we just did. There, alright. So, you'll remember, Minion ended, or the original seam line on Minion ended right about right here. So we started up a little bit. We started our seam, we backstitched, and then we kept going. We came and joined it. We've got this beautiful, beautiful joining of all of our seams right here, joined up nicely, very, very nicely. Okay, and then it ended right here. See? Right there. So now all we'll do is we'll keep attaching blocks. There we go. Okay, we'll keep going. So now I'm going to keep working this way in this quadrant right here. So let me get the blocks that I need together for the next section, and then we'll keep going. I'll give you guys a couple more examples, and then, and then I'll go from there. Okay, so I got our next section of blocks. So we're going to sew this block to this one, and we'll have to end our seam because they are not the same length, so we will be ending it. And then I've got this block. We're going to attach this one to the top, and then underneath it I've got two more blocks that we can sew together. So let's start with this section here. So let me zoom in. All right. So I checked the orientation on both of these blocks already. They are good. They are right sides up. So now we're going to fold this one down and lay it face down on top of this block. Okay. Now I have to sew on this side, so I'm going to turn it and have it facing my machine. I'm just going to line up the top. There we go. Alright, put that under. Take a couple of stitches. Okay. I'm just lining it up with the rest of this line. And here we go. Okay. Checking the rest. Okay, so we've got probably about another inch or so, maybe 2 inches, and then we got to stop. Alright, there you go. So now I'm going to go ahead and do a back stitch, and done. Okay, so here we go, we've completed that. See, got a nice little lock stitch right in there. Okay, so now I'm just going to move this whole section over to the ironing board. I'm going to set my seam real quick with a little bit of heat and steam, and I'm going to fold it back and give it an iron. There we go. Alright, so here it is so far. Here's where it ended. We've got a nice press right there. Very nice and even on this side. Obviously, this side not so much. It will be once we continue. Okay, so I'm going to set this aside for now. Let me get my next section. We got this little American flag. Okay, and then we're going to sew this little block on the top. So we'll go ahead, well, make sure it's oriented correctly, and it is. So we'll go ahead and lay it face down. We're going to turn it. Okay, line everything up. So, put that under. There you go. And this one, we can complete the seam because both blocks are the same size. So, lost that one on the bottom a little bit. There you go. And sometimes the material slips. Like this was that polyester, these American flag shorts were the polyester, so they're kind of slippery. There we go. So there's that. Check the back. Beautiful. Golly, I love this machine. All right, so this is done. So we'll go ahead and take it to the ironing board. And I'm going to set that seam in, roll it back, and give it a good iron. Alright. Okay. Here's this section. Look at that. Very nice. Here's the back. Look at how nicely that's laying down. Beautiful. Alright. So we'll go ahead and set this aside as well. And I'll get that next section that I told you about. I put a pin in it because I had it underneath something and I didn't want to get mixed up. So I'll take that out now. Okay, so now we'll go ahead and get it lined up under the machine. And I had already orientated these blocks before I put the pin in, so I know they are going the right direction. Is orientated a word? Oriented? I don't know. Alright, so we'll take a couple of stitches. Okay, I'm just checking the rest of it. Alright, perfect. And let's keep going. Oops, scooch it over and keep going. Again, ironing board, set the seam, and I'm going to iron it back, but before I do, this shirt has a logo, so I'm going to put my my little safety cloth on top of it, and then I'm going to iron it back. Okay, so, I know you guys can't see it, so I might as well go ahead and show you. There you go. All right. Okay, so I already set this part. So now I'm just going to, I'm not rolling it back, I'm not pulling it back all the way just yet. I'm going to cover up my logo. And I'm just covering up the logo. I'm not going to cover up this shirt just cuz I need to make sure I can get my iron in there to move this out. Okay, so I got my whole logo covered up, and now just going to push this back, move up here, push it back. There you go. Move that. Look at that. Perfect. Nice and flat. Look at that. That seam is laying down nicely. Beautiful. Got a little bit of wetness from my steam. Alright, so now, let's zoom out. We'll come back over here and lay out what we just sewed together. Okay, so, got this section here. Got this section here. And this section, let me turn you some more. There we go. This section here is actually going to get sewed together to this section. Okay, and look at that. That is the, those are the exact lengths that they need to be. And I know you can just barely see it right down here. But right here is lined up, and then up here is lined up. Okay, so these will get sewn together, and I'm looking at my picture. I'm referring over here to my computer, to the picture of my layout. So yeah, so I'm gonna go ahead and sew this together. Now, because this is a simple straight seam, I'm not gonna show that on the camera. I'm gonna sew this together, and then I'm gonna get my next set of blocks together, and then I'll show you guys maybe one more where I join the seams together, okay? Okay, so here's the next section that I'm gonna be putting together. So I've got this bulldog section right here, this block, and I just sewed this little flower on, okay? But again, I didn't finish the seam right there, see? Because I eventually have to put something on the bottom of that, okay? This is going to be attached to this blue Yankees block. Now, this is not attached to anything currently on any side, so I have to sew it to the top of this. This section here is going to get attached to our American flag section. Okay, right here. Okay, and right now, this bottom does not line up with the top, the Yankees block, and this flower block, because we have not sewn this seam line right here. So once we do, we'll get, we'll lose a little bit of material from this block and from this one, and then it'll be the same size as this block section right here. So let's go ahead and attach the Yankees block to these three blocks. So let me move this section, put it to the side. Okay, so we're gonna bring this over, and all I'm gonna do, well, I was gonna fold this down, but because this is such a big block compared to these, I think I'm going to fold these up. There you go, I hope you can see that. Okay, so now I'm just gonna grab this, and I'm going to turn it and bring it to the sewing machine. Okay, so let me check. Let me change you guys up here. There we go, so let's zoom in. There, okay. Alright, so now we need to readjust and make sure this is aligned, because right now it is not. Alright. And I'm just dragging my nails across it just to move it just a little, couple of hairs. Okay, we'll take a couple of stitches. There we go. Now we can adjust some more. Okay. There we go. Okay, let's keep going. Okay, and adjust some more. Okay, and that'll line up beautifully when we get the next block attached to this Yankees block. Oops. And again, as this gets bigger, it's going to get more and more difficult to get your seams to line up, just because you have the weight, you know, pulling it down and to your side, or, you know, you keep having to move it around on your table. Got a couple more inches. Okay, so again, we cannot finish this seam because we still need to attach another block to this Yankees block eventually. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and go maybe like another half inch, and then I'm going to backstitch and cut my thread. All right. Okay, so off to the iron. Lay that down. And again, my Yankees block over here has the logo on it, so we need to be careful that we don't smear that with the heat of our iron. So I'm just going to use my fingers and I'm pressing it back. And I'm going to put my extra piece of t-shirt down to protect my logo. Oops. There we go. All right, and I'm going to press it back with the iron. Okay, so let me zoom out. Alright, so here's what we got so far. We got that sewn together. Okay, and now we can add the section onto this side, which is right there. So now they should line up perfectly. Alright, and they do. Look at that. Beautiful. Alright, so now I'm just going to lay this on top. There you go, fold it over. And again, you can use pins to do this to keep it all nice and straight. Now this seam I will be able to finish because I don't have to attach anything to the top or the bottom. So I'm not going to show you that because it's just a straight seam. Alright, so let me go ahead and do that. Okay, so I went ahead and sewed the straight stitch right along here. I went ahead and set my seam and then I pressed it open. Okay, so now we've got this whole section, which is the Yankees, flower, the American flag, and those, oh, is that two blocks over there? Okay, so down here, this is where it's open, right here. We did not finish our seam, so I got my finger in there. Okay, so now we can attach the next section, which is our minion section. Okay, so what we're gonna do, let me turn you a little bit. Okay, so we're going to attach this block right here to our flower block, and it's going to go all the way across to the edge of our minion block. Okay, so again, you can use pins. You can pin at the two edges and then in the middle if you want. You can pin more than that if you like, or you don't have to pin at all. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to flip minion back. And I'm going to lay him face down on these blocks. There we go. Okay. So now, this is the line that we're going to be sewing on all the way across. It's a very long stitch, which is good. Nothing overly complicated. All right. And this, we can finish our seam. So I will actually start over here on this side. I'm going to go all the way, and I'm going to finish it off right there. Okay, so let me go ahead and do that. Okay, so let me show you what we've put together so far. Okay, now again, this isn't done, but I wanted to show y'all what we've got so far, okay? So look at that. We've got all of these sections together already. Okay, so now this seam right here is what I just sewed. I set my seam, I pressed it open, so now this is done right here. So now I'm just going to keep adding the rest of my blocks. Again, I work in quadrants, so once I get this quadrant done, I'll set it aside. I'll start working on my next one. That one, and then I'll go to the third one, and then I'll finish with the fourth one, and then I'll put them all together. But yeah, so honestly, this is probably the part that might take you, I don't know, a couple of minutes to get your brain wrapped around. It took me a little bit to get my brain wrapped around it. But once I did, I just thought to myself, oh my gosh, this is a lot easier than I thought it was. So yeah, I think I've given you guys enough examples to get you going. If not, let me know. I can make another video. So yeah, I'm going to finish putting my whole quilt top together. And then once I do, I will come back and show you guys the completed top. And then we can go on to the next step from there. Okay, everybody. So I've finished putting all the blocks together. And I'm ready to show you guys the finished quilt top. So here it is. Look at that. Not too shabby, huh, guys? It's not too terribly hard to do. You know, once you get to doing it and you get the hang of it, it's actually rather easy. So yeah, so this is the finished quilt top. I've added a border onto it. These are the two Izod shirts that my client gave me, the salmon color and like the light blue or baby blue. So with the exception of this little blue block and that salmon one right there, this border, I used the entire front and back of both Izod shirts. It is a what's the finished measurements? Let's see. It's a 2-inch border. They are 2-inch borders. This one is obviously a little bit bigger. It's a 2 1/4 because I still have to take up the seam allowance once I put my binding on. But it's 2-inch border. And as of right now, the quilt measurements are 97 inches by 101 inches. And that's perfect. I like my quilts to be, my queen size quilts to be 93.5 by 101. So this fits, it's pretty darn close. So 97 by 101 is what we finished at right now. And it shouldn't get any bigger. Once I put the binding on, it shouldn't get any bigger. But yeah, so this is it. This is what we've done. Yeah, not too terribly bad. So I think I'll pretty much end the video here. The last steps, that I still have to do is I have to piece together my backing. Here's my backing material. It's just kind of like a beige, tannish, almost like yellowy color. I have to piece that together. Then I have to lay that out, put down my batting, and then make my quilt sandwich. And after that, I'm going to quilt it all together. But the main purpose of me doing this video was to show you guys how to make the t-shirt style quilt. And that's what this is. And obviously the main difference between this style of quilt and I guess more traditional quilts is that there is no rhyme or reason. You're not going to find continuous straight rows. You're not going to find continuous straight columns. It's just kind of a collage. It's a mishmash of shirts. There's, you know what I mean? It's all different sizes, shapes, colors. Well, I guess not shapes. It's all pretty much, you know, right angles. But yeah. So, and you know, like I said, once you get your brain wrapped around having to stop a seam in the middle and then continue it later on, it's really rather easy. So yeah, so this is it. This is the quilt that we've created. If you have any questions or anything, go ahead and leave them in the comments section, and I do my best to answer all questions. If you have comments or suggestions, go ahead and leave those too. Yeah, if you're interested in having me make another video or something like that, go ahead and let me know, and I'll do my best to, you know, record something that you want to see or that you have more questions on. So yeah. All right. Until next time, I will see you guys later.